My name is Nader Pouratian. I'm an assistant professor of neurosurgery at UCLA. The name of my lab is the Neurosurgical Brain Mapping and Restoration Lab. We are primarily focusing on Parkinson's disease at this point. And the reason for that is because Parkinson's disease affects such a large part of the population, and it's a very disabling disease. It's also a disease that we do surgery for. There's brain surgery for it. And we do a surgery called deep brain stimulation surgery. And so our goal is really to use the operating room as a laboratory, as a source of information and data, so that we can understand the treatment that we do, understand how we improve Parkinson's disease, and then hopefully use that knowledge to apply it to other diseases as well, like depression and chronic pain and other psychiatric diseases.
What's happening is that blue box above the patient's head is what we call a micro drive, and we're controlling it with this remote control here, and we're advancing the microelectrode 200 microns at a time, so 1/5 of a millimeter at a time. So we're basically mapping out our path to the target. Then once we have that confirmed, we will swap out that electrode with this permanent implant here. And once we have this in, we'll get x-rays, make sure we are where we think we want to be, and then we'll test the patient as well. And that's why we have the patient awake during the surgery.
So I grew up right here in Los Angeles and have spent much of my life at UCLA. So I did my undergraduate degree here at UCLA in neuroscience. I'm a scientist because the idea of asking questions and trying to understand how things work is very intrinsic to me. That's just how I work. And it's very interesting because now that I have a daughter and I see how she thinks exactly like I did as a child, always analyzing things, trying to put things together, trying to make sense of how things work. I remember in sixth grade for my science fair project, I built a house and I built an alarm system for it and figured out the circuits by myself, and I had no formal training at all in circuits. I just really loved doing that. And so science as a field has always been very interesting to me. Having the operating room as my laboratory really forces me to live two lives at once.
All right, so we are going to get an x-ray now.
You know, my first responsibility is always to my patient and doing the right surgery for my patient. So a lot of what we do is standard clinical procedures. We have experiments that are set up on the cart so that we can collect signals in real time. And the real challenge is that we don't want to be too much of a nuisance to the patient. So they are doing us a huge favor, and in the community and the world a huge favor, by giving us their time in the operating room. And so we like to be as efficient as possible, get as much data as possible. This lead was designed to stimulate the brain, just like a pacemaker stimulates the heart. It has four contacts on it. It's a total distance of about 10.5 millimeters or 1 centimeter of the brain that we're collecting data from. It's meant for stimulating, and what we're doing that's different in the operating room is we're not just stimulating, we're actually recording through that electrode. And I guess that recalls, you know, going back to what inspired me. You know, I realized as a young kid, I remember a microphone, you know, you can actually hook up a microphone to a speaker outlet and listen to music through a microphone. I thought, wow, a microphone is the same thing as a speaker. And so it's the same idea here. So the stimulator is the same thing that we can record through. That's exactly what we're doing in the operating. We're taking advantage of that unique opportunity of using the speaker as a microphone to record from the brain.
There's a good example of cells firing.
So the reason why I work on Parkinson's disease is mostly a practical issue, and then something that I've come to become passionate about because of the patients that I take care of. So it's, you know, you normally think that it is someone you knew or some kind of passion for the field that drove me to it. In fact, it was the other way around for me. In my clinical practice, I was treating a lot of patients with Parkinson's disease. It became natural that was my subject matter. Those are the people I could really study. But the more I've been in clinical practice, the more I've taken care of these patients, the more I've learned about the disease itself through my research. Because it's one of those things where, you know, I remember when I first started doing Parkinson's research, someone said to me, well, you know, it's just a tremor, isn't it? And you realize it's so much more. And the disease and how it affects the brain is so much more complicated than anyone really appreciates. And so there's so much to be understood and there's so much potential. The other reason I'm particularly interested in Parkinson's disease is it's a disease that we have a really good treatment for, but we don't understand the treatment. And it's sort of, I want to backpedal a little bit in that I want to understand how the treatment works. And if we can understand how the treatment works, maybe we can reverse engineer and figure out how we can treat other diseases as well that we haven't been as successful at. It's a passion for the disease as well as a passion for the patients that I take care of at this point. So I think being a scientist is actually one of the most exciting and fun parts of my professional life. Because what we do as scientists, yes, we sit at a computer and we analyze signals, but it's the times when we get to sit as a lab and review the data and brainstorm and say, you know, what do we actually think is going on? You know, why is this happening? What do we have to do to understand this a little bit better? It's that intellectual stimulation, the back and forth. It's really exciting for me to work with students and see them sort of mature through the process of learning how to think as a scientist. That's really what's exciting in life. You know, a lot of what we do as doctors is very routine. We do the same surgeries all the time, but for me, bringing the science into the operating room is really what's exciting and what I think makes a bigger difference for the world than each patient that I treat. I love seeing my patients after surgery because I love how much it helps them, but I love the thought even more that what I'm doing with them and how they're helping me in the operating room might help even more people beyond that. I think what we've seen recently, especially in students, is what we call the millennial effect. You know, are very used to living in the era of the internet where there is an answer. You can always look up an answer. And the hard part about it is that there aren't always answers, and the only way to learn is to really go out and try. Another way for students to sort of explore science and research is to go to local conferences. There's often, you know, student-run conferences, and that might be a good opportunity and much less intimidating than going to a national conference. But I think the other thing I would say is if you're interested in research, find something that is interesting to you. So a lot of people will end up going to a lab that's easy to get into, but they don't really like it. I remember talking to one student who said, you know, I'm doing this Drosophila research, which is research on flies. I said, well, are you interested in it? And they said, well, no, I don't really like it, but, you know, the lab was, you know, it was easy to get into the lab. I said, well, then you're doing the wrong thing. You know, you shouldn't do something you're not interested in. You should have a passion about it, and that's going to carry you much further than just getting your foot in the door. So an early foot in the door is not necessarily better than the right foot in the door.